Hey everyone, this is for all people around the world celebrating Christmas like nothing is happening, calling for celebrations. Do you hear this sounds? Okay, this is bombing around us. Jesus was Palestinian, and now Palestinians are subjected to genocide. So imagine how would be your celebrations if Jesus was alive and around us and subjected to genocide also as his people. Do you hear the ambulances, the unarmed plans over our heads, the bombings? Okay, we're living all of this during this night, during the past nights and the upcoming nights. We have been killed. We are now subjected to killing and to bombings, and we'll be killed also if no one moves. Yani, simply, it's 69 days of bombing, displacement, starvation, being under bombing, and you're just calling for a normal, peaceful life, full of Eids, Christmas, sweets, and warm winter nights. If you're celebrating Christmas for Jesus, then Jesus was Palestinian. If you are celebrating Christmas for just celebrating Christmas, then you cannot be normal in an abnormal world, in an explosive world, especially in over the Palestinians and Gazans' lives. So, I don't know why are you celebrating, but you should be ashamed. Actually, you should be ashamed. If you hear the unarmed plans over our heads, the Zanani, if you hear the bombings around us and still want to celebrate, then... yeah, you need to do something. You hear this? Okay, Merry Christmas. مجدنا وعهدنا واجب من الوفا يهزنا يهزنا عزنا
الأشياء النادر الحصول عليها في قطاع غزة في ظل العدوان المستمر منذ 7 أو 8 يوم. شباب قديش لها الحرب؟ قديش لها؟ 69 يوم منذ 69 يوما والعدوان مستمر على غزة. إنك تلاقي مي باردة في راجل كريم جاب لنا إياها، لا ومشبرة كمان. واو، هاي أقصى أحلامنا، لقينا مي باردة في غزة في ظل الحرب وفي ظل العدوان وفي ظل قطع الكهرباء وفي ظل الحمد لله على الحال.
سماء
والله انا
Good morning. I keep on saying that I don't know. I don't know. Maybe my English is not that good. Where I actually reach the point where I go live or record a video and I actually don't know what to say about what is happening here on the ground. A storm hit the coastal enclave. There is heavy rain. People thought that maybe this is going to ease things up, but no. Continuous air raids, shelling, bombings everywhere. Yes.
Never stop sharing, never stop protesting. I know the war is taking so long. I know it's been around 3 months, but don't leave Gaza or Palestinians alone. Don't get bored of posting and protesting and boycotting. You know, see us as humans.
And you know you're going to be okay, huh?
It has to be okay at the end.
No, and you are going to be okay.
I hope.
You will, Hachufi.
I hope so. You know, like for now, what everyone is hoping for, like just to hear the word ceasefire, Anjad.
Oh, wallah al-azim.
صباح الخير هل جهزت شنطة أغراضي هاي شنطة الألعاب بتاعتي وهي الدبدوب المفضل لإلي هاي أغراضنا واليوم لازم نطلع عرفة بسبب الوضع صوت الشبكات وصوت القصف كتير قرب علينا وصوت الطخ كان قريب علينا كتير ولازم اليوم نطلع عرفة وبقول في مكان في رفح آمن وبكل غزة فيش فيها مكان آمن وإن شاء الله استصلح على خير
من نعناع
مصر الشهيدة أنا زحيم من غزة الزيتون
شايفك حاضن البول تاع زوجك إيش كينا
هذا آخر ما تبقى مني
طب ليش أخذت البول تاعي؟
قبل 6 شهور من الحرب تزوجنا واليوم أعلن شهادة سيبني لحالي الله يرحمه ويتمه ويتذكر انه ما ينسانيش في المرحلة
انت شعورك لما انفجأت فيه لقيت لك مع الشعور
قلت وقلت اغلى من قلبة العقل
فيش نظافة ما فيش توفير فيش غذاء فيش مية فيش يعني فيش نظافة يعني عايشين معاناة بغزة جد معاناة بغزة مؤسسة يعني ما فيش فوض نحط مطر نحط شرايط مطر نحط شرايط ما فيش فوض نسح الحمامات وسخ ما نقدرش نتحمم فيها جد ما فيش نظافة شخصية نظف نظف حالنا الصراحة الحمام يعني أنا اللي كنت أتحمم يوم صرت ما أتحممش كل 7 مرة صرت أتحمم وولادي زي بالضبط كل 7 مرة لما نتحمم كل 7 بتجينا المية لما تجينا المية كله بيجرى على المية الشاطر اللي بدها تتحمم واللي بدها تغسل ولادها تغسل الأواعي وبالنسبة للقطن فيش قطن شهرية عندنا فيش قطن بنجيب الشرايط تاعت ولادنا بننزعهم وصرنا نستخدمها
حكاية الدورة الشهزبية وملاحة الفوط ومن ناحية هون ما فيش متوفر كتير يعني كان النساء التجئن اللي عندها أولاد صغار تستخدم البامبرز تبع أولادها يعني وهذا بيسبب أمراض للنساء يعني شوفي كيف لما بيكون الفوط غير صحية شوفي ايش المضار والالتهابات الصحية وزي هيك
أكيد عندنا النساء بيطلبوا الفوط الصحية لكن مش موفرة للجميع يمكن موفرها يعني لناس معينين أما بالنسبة للجزء الكبير مش هنقدر نوفر لهم لأنها مش موجودة بسبب تسكير المعابر أو منع الإخوان التجار من تدخيل المساعدات لقطاع غزة
لقينا صارت الضربة لقينا في نص الشارع نص حباب دار نص يمكن بعيد عنا يمكن بشهر بعيد 20 متر
حسب الله نعم الوكيل مع
السلامة حسب الله نعم الوكيل
It is December 14th. I have updates for today. If I miss anything, please comment it. Staff and patients are being forced to gather at the Kamal Adwan Hospital yard. This is from the head of the pediatrics department at Kamal Adwan Hospital. There are more than 65 injured people in the hospital courtyard without any medical care. We might be facing a new massacre in the hospital and we don't know what will happen. The situation in the hospital is extremely horrifying and we haven't been able to evacuate some of the injured. Everyone in the hospital, including the patients, is in the hospital courtyard amidst cold weather. International organizations have not taken the steps towards protecting the injured and the medical staff at the hospital. The IOF has released footage of what it says is the arrest of more than 70 Hamas operatives in the vicinity of the Kamal Adwan Hospital in the Gaza Strip. Videos and pictures posted on the Army's social media page show young men without their shirts on seemingly surrendering to IOF. The military said in a statement that it had located weapons inside a building in the area and was transferring the operatives to another location for further questioning. A number of people previously arrested in a similar manner, including being stripped to their underwear, have been recognized by relatives and colleagues as not belonging to Hamas, including a well-known local journalist. Almost half of Gaza's population is now in Rafah in the south. IOF illegally detained 18 Palestinians in the occupied West Bank, including a 12-year-old child. 12 Palestinians have been martyred since the start of the IOF raids in Jenin. Musa Ahmed Musa Khatib, a 17-year-old boy, is one of the martyrs that were shot by IOF in the chest in Jenin. This is the longest raid that Jenin has seen since the Second Intifada. People say they are running out of food supplies. They cannot go out of the house. About 500 men have been rounded up, according to the Palestinian Prisoners Society. Most of them, about 400, have been released after questioning, but some needed medical treatment afterwards. The Palestinian Red Crescent Society continues to bring the injured and the killed from Jenin to hospitals. Even with the IOF attempting to interfere and stop them from doing so, they continue their efforts. And this is what is happening at one of the hospitals in Jenin, the governmental hospital. IOF is forcing patients and the ones accompanying them to undress, and they are abusing them during their arrest. I'm going to do an update post on the axis of resistance in all of the groups and just, you know, what they've been doing in Gaza and as well as outside of Gaza in a separate video and a separate video for Lebanon as well. Keep talking and keep spreading information. From the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. The Ministry of Health in Gaza has just reported in the past few hours, the IOF have carried out 18 massacres across the Gaza Strip. IOF forces have transformed Kamal Adwan Hospital into a barracks and staging area for military operations, threatening to evacuate the wounded and sick to Al-Shifa Medical Complex, which lacks essential medical facilities, effectively sentencing them to death. The occupation has arrested 70 medical staff and wounded, including hospital director Dr. Ahmed Al-Kahlout, and is forcing staff and the injured. The health situation in South Gaza hospitals is the worst due to a lack of capacity, treatment facilities, and medical staff. They are choosing between serious cases to save as many lives as possible from the large numbers arriving. IOF forces continue to detain 38 health personnel under harsh, inhumane conditions, including Dr. Mahmoud Abu Salmiya, subjecting them to interrogation, torture, and starvation. IOF aggression against the health system resulted in martyrdom of 300 health workers and the destruction of 102 ambulances. IOF targeted 138 health institutions, putting 22 hospitals and 52 health centers out of service. The health and humanitarian situation in shelters is unbearable, with fears of tens of thousands dying due to the spread of infectious diseases, malnutrition, lack of clean drinking water and personal hygiene, and absence of health services. Health teams have recorded 327,000 cases of infectious diseases from shelters, a number that represents only those who could reach the health centers. This is the only update we've received in a while today because of the communications blackout. 18 massacres and acts of genocide in the last few hours. And Israel solidified the fact that with or without international support, they are going to continue doing what they're doing. Somebody needs to stop this with force. How many days in are we? And every day seems to get worse than the last. We should have had a ceasefire. We should have had a ceasefire by now. It should have never come to this point.
Hey guys, so this account is officially being censored. I think I'm removed from the FYP. If you guys don't mind letting me know if you saw this on the FYP or not, but this is what's happening. It did censor my stories, removed all the sounds, regards to my ability to open the view details and appeal it. They restored it now, but like 7 or 8 stories were completely removed. And there's an odd pattern in which the video is trending. It reaches around 400, then automatically drops in the next minute. does the same, trends really, really quickly, goes back to 400, 500, then drops. So it keeps going up and down until it completely dies down. And that's what makes me assume that they don't want people to see this. Okay, this is what you need to know in regards to what's happening in Gaza. Today is December 14, 2023, and I collected these over the last couple days. I'll attach the report to my story. Heartbreaking report. Footage has emerged showing two Palestinian girls, kids, I think teenagers, standing on top of a building in which the building was airstriked, a portion of it. And there was a fire in the bottom left corner, I believe. And they recognized their father, I believe, or mother. Their parent was the one burning in it. I have that footage and I'll attach it to my story. And also there's reports showing that Israeli soldiers were converting a school into a military outpost in the Shujaya neighborhood shortly before they were killed by H group. Now also to add, there was pictures that showed Israeli forces gathering hundreds of Palestinian civilians in Gaza and they forced them into a ditch. And they're seen sitting there. And now sources have reported that the few that were released stated that the soldiers threatened to bury them alive in that ditch. And speaking of threats, so sources also did report that there was witness statements saying that a number of Palestinian women, children, and babies included were executed at point blank by Israeli forces while they were sheltering inside a UN-run school in North Gaza. The school is called Shadia Abu Ghazali. And as a result of that massacre, 15 bodies were recovered so far. And the reporters on the ground also investigated to see whether there was an airstrike or not, but there was no remnants of an airstrike or any shells in the area. Their wounds are from bullet holes that happened close range and they were executed at point blank. And where's the global outrage for that? Now, in the West Bank, in Jenin specifically, these past 3 days have been hell. They besieged the eastern neighborhoods of Jenin. There has been many civilians being wrongfully detained. They actually also rearrested the freed prisoner, Nader Masaad, after storming his home in Jenin as well. And they conducted very frequent arrest campaigns, arresting people left and right in Jenin. They also prevented the entry and exit of the city. They also besieged a hospital in Jenin because, you know, that's their go-to move. And they didn't let anybody go in and go out. They didn't let the wounded come in. So I read from sources that a couple people died in the streets, but I don't know how accurate that one is. It was reported that the 3-day aggression on Jenin left 12 martyrs. Now, the Ministry of Health in Gaza actually announced that the childhood vaccinations have completely run out in the strip, and they're calling on relevant authorities to provide them with them so that they can prevent a health catastrophe on the newborns. The death toll has reached 18,787, and more than 50,000 are injured. And I also want to emphasize the fact that the weather conditions are terrible. There's a lot of displaced people that actually don't have shelter because the tents that they're building up are not reliable for winter weather and storms. And there was actually a flood, and I have footage showing a man carrying a woman out of an ambulance in the middle of a flood, putting her on her shoulder to carry her to dry area so that she can get treated. And also showing a boy holding an unalived kid across the flooded area. He was wrapped in white cloth. And which hospital are they obsessed with now? The Kamal Adwan Hospital. So they barricaded the Kamal Adwan Hospital and they're using it as their military operations and they're demanding everybody under threat to evacuate the wounded, the sick, to Al Shifa Hospital. Now I just want to mention the fact that everybody forgot about Al Shifa Hospital since that was one of the first hospitals in which they claimed H Group had tunnels under there. Whatever happened to that story? That story died down pretty quick, didn't it? And because Al-Shifa Hospital was also besieged before, things were already destroyed in there, they don't have the proper materials they need, the proper equipment, the proper access to the tools needed to actually sustain people's lives and heal the wounded. They've threatened 12 kids in care due to the lack of milk there and life support equipment, so. And shit's been going down in Lebanon, on the southern borders of Lebanon and the northern borders of Israel. They targeted a 3-story building yesterday, killed civilians. An official number has not been reported yet, but they're also reporting that there's wounded as well. Now, according to Israeli Channel 12, Israeli will issue a proposal for an agreed reality to... If they reject Israeli's proposal, they will be forced to act militarily. That doesn't sound like a proposal to me. That sounds like a threat. But they essentially asked them to have the complete removal of to a minimum of 5 to 7 kilometers from the border, so it's not possible to fire directly at Israeli settlements. And they're asking for no change in the area after the removal of, meaning that they want to prevent them from reconstructing outposts that were destroyed by the IOF. And according to the Israeli minister Benny Gantz, if doesn't retreat from the border area, Israel will have no choice but to launch a broad military campaign in the north. Now, mind you, I will clarify that they didn't attack Hezbollah, actually attacked civilians and journalists and homes. Whereas the other way around, they were targeting military outposts. And they already threatened a while back that they were going to turn Beirut and the south of Lebanon into Gaza. So for those who don't know, they tried that in 2006, got their ass kicked, and left. There's way more to report on, but it's hard squeezing the time in. But I think I'm just going to do a live today at around 8:30. Spread the word. Don't stop talking about this. Take care and God bless.
Three Signs Israel is Losing, Part 26. Netanyahu is still trying to gaslight us.
I'm gonna continue until the end.
Hello, this is the end. The whole world voted for a ceasefire, even your home country, Poland. You dragged Sleepy Joe in your downfall. Started an impeachment process for him. Don't you feel bad for him? After all, his dad was one of the survivors of the Hamas attack. Even Donald Trump isn't fooled by you anymore. Said yesterday that he realized you are the problem. Israel's resident psychopath in the UK, after she officially announced that they don't want a two-state solution, Rishi Sunak, who finally got hold of a mirror and realized he's not exactly white, stated that this is unacceptable. All violent settlers will be banned from entering the UK. Just now that Taylor Swift is supporting Gaza, which songs are the diaper forces gonna use for their TikTok dances?
Remember how I said that people are more obsessed with a hypothetical genocide than the real genocide happening in Palestine and the harassment and violence that is stemming out of it here in the US? So this 7th grade teacher was arrested on child cruelty and terroristic threat charges. And that is because one of his students said that she finds the Israeli flag offensive due to Israelis killing Palestinians, to which he said he would kick her effing ASS, slit her goddamn throat, and drag her ASS outside. And her head off. Tell me now, why are we still concerned about hypotheticals when real genocide is happening in Palestine? And when people that are defending Palestine are getting harassed, are getting killed, are getting shot.
Nasreen wants to share another day in the life with you all. This is the mattress that she sleeps on. She wakes up and has a small piece of bread with za'atar and olive oil, and then she makes a cup of tea. She went outside today. She saw a man filling up his car with cooking oil. Yes, cooking oil, because there is no fuel in Gaza. People are also having to use metal tin cans to cook and keep warm. She also wanted to show you all the tents that people are sleeping in. Now that it's rainy, the situation is very difficult in those tents. A lot of them are flooding and wet. Charging her electronics is a hassle, so she has to walk to a neighbor's house, and he has solar energy, so everyone is using his place to charge. It's also a very big hassle to go and find water, so you have to stand in those lines. She found a stationery store and got this crochet hook and is trying to crochet to let the time pass and just do something with her day. Because it's been raining a lot the past few days, this is her family collecting water so that they can reuse it. A week into the genocide, Nasreen asked me to send her some ebooks so that she could stay busy reading. She says the sound of the zannana, or the surveillance drone, is super loud today.
Behind me is an Israeli soldier standing on a member of a mosque while taking turns having fun desecrating the mosque with other Israeli soldiers. And this is how they sounded from outside the mosque, and this is their military vehicle.
Hey, God.
The minbar, or al-minbar, is a special spot in the mosque in which only the imam or the sheikh is allowed to step up on it. It comes in many shapes and designs. The one you saw in the video is more modern look. These videos that are filmed by Israeli soldiers themselves and sharing them among each other doesn't just show how sick and twisted the most moral army in the world, but also shows how superior they think over the Palestinians, not just from an ethnic background, but also from a religious point of view. and how superiors they think over Muslims, getting into their mosque and desecrating it. And this is not the first thing that we see from Israeli soldiers desecrating Islamic stuff. This is an Israeli soldier in one of the UN schools in Gaza, entered a classroom and wrote on the board a Jewish law, which is called Beth Din, and put his machine gun on an Islamic rug, in a gesture to show that they're gonna apply their Jewish laws on Muslims. Another Israeli soldier posted this video on TikTok in one of the Palestinians' homes in Gaza, captioned POV You're Freeing Palestine, and dragged an Islamic prayer rug into the bathroom, stepping on it while doing his business. Another clip of Israeli soldiers setting up Hanukkah menorah on top of Palestinian home in Gaza. Another clip of Israel throwing flyers quoted with a verse of the Quran. The verse says the flood seized them while they were wrongdoers. And at the end of the verse, they put the Star of David, the formal IDF sign. All of that is enough to prove to you these are not sporadic incidents. These are systematic beliefs. And the reason I'm saying this is a reflection of Israel as a society. All of these Israelis with the military uniform, in a few weeks, they take off the uniforms and put on some civilian clothes. And in a few weeks, they come back, put on their uniform and continue desecrating Islamic places. This will never get an international reaction. But if a Muslim extremist entered a church or a synagogue and did the same, they will be front page all over Western news. And I'm specifying with extremist because no true Muslim believes in desecrating other religious places. Extremism can come in different forms in all religions and with no exception.
Gaza is in another blackout, and every single time they do this, they do unimaginable things. This cannot become normal. And while this is happening, this is what Joe Biden is out here talking about. He wants the Israeli occupation to be more careful. He is supplying them with more weapons, and he's asking for more money to give to them. But he wants them to be careful. This is what he said the other day. He warned that they could lose international support. He does not care about Palestinians. He doesn't even care about Americans. He cares about the PR of the Israeli occupation.
So I have a question. I'm not a professional or anything, but is it normal to strip down the enemy and then give them their weapon back? Or is this the new Hamas uniform and this is indeed how they were found? The level of mockery is driving me bananas.
Every accusation is a confession. Every single accusation by you-know-who is just another confession for something that they have done. They have just found unalived bodies of men, women, children, and even newborn babies that have been executed at point blank. People and politicians have condemned Hamas to the ground for their actions on October the 7th, even though so many of these accusations later turned out to be fake and just pieces of propaganda. Yet they will stay absolutely silent when atrocities like this have been committed. They will purposely turn on a blind eye, because you know what? They don't really care about human rights. They don't care about the just side. This isn't about self-defense. This never was about self-defense. Otherwise, they would have stopped it. Instead, they're green-lighting for these atrocities to continue to happen. But we cannot.
How do you not fall for propaganda? Let's look at the IDF and media literacy. I'm Morgan. I usually talk about relationships, but I do also have a degree in nonfiction storytelling with a focus on the ethics of editing. And let me tell you, what they leave out might even be more important than what they keep in. I'll give a couple examples. This official IDF YouTube claims that soldiers are giving aid to Gaza civilians. Where are the civilians? Where are the medical staff? Where is the Arabic writing? Why is that written in English? Do I even have to ask if this is staged? Because why would you leave out the people, the main point of your photo op, unless the real point was to give English speakers a fake feel-good moment? Example 2 from the official IDF TikTok. They tell you, just imagine all the horrible things that could happen to people you love. They say, that's how we feel, fade to black. You are the official military TikTok. You just got us upset and scared. What are you proposing? Go ahead. Finish your sales pitch. Why leave out the call to action, the main point of an ad? unless the real point is to get people upset so they don't ask more questions. When I say look for what's missing, I don't just mean counter arguments. I mean, what doesn't add up in their own story? What is downplayed, blurry, strategically vague? If there's actually nothing to hide, then these questions won't be a threat. Stay critical of a sales pitch on your screen, especially when it's the government or a person in power.
One of the copper, because it ain't silver, linings of the many atrocities that are gripping the world right now is that it has led many people to question everything that Western society has ever taught us. And I just want to encourage more of that going forward. Question the idea of crime. How a citizen shoplifting or misrepresenting their income to get benefits is seen as more egregious than a government that allows its constituents to suffer in poverty, often driving them to desperate measures. All while allocating billions to war crimes. Question the carceral system. How we're told that it's for rehabilitation and that cruel and unusual punishment is never to be inflicted. So how do we see things like a man being eaten to death by bed bugs and another one being boiled in a scalding shower by guards who were never charged? Question how, as a civilian with no training, you're expected to stay perfectly calm while staring in the face of a firearm. But an officer with training can shoot an unarmed person and claim that he just reacted out of fear. Question religion and how we live under the power of controlling white men who immediately go to punitive measures when you don't follow their agenda, and that's exactly how Christianity frames God. Question what freedom represents in a society where you can't even protest your living conditions without the fear of being arrested or murdered. Question race. Question gender. Question sexuality. Question your education and what you know about countries outside of the U.S. And lastly, question the term terrorist, because we all know they're very selective in who gets called that.
Did you know that Albert Einstein was against the creation of a Jewish state? As a Jew from Germany who had to flee when Hitler rose to power, he knew firsthand the dire consequences of anti-Semitism. He called the Zionists who invaded Palestine and massacred civilians terrorist bands and likened them to the Nazi and fascist parties. Using that strong of language just 3 years after the Holocaust is the harshest language I could imagine anyone saying. It is nuanced though, because Albert Einstein supported Zionism in a sense, but not the creation of a Jewish state. He thought that Jews could live harmoniously with Arabs in Jerusalem, and that people could flee the persecution that they were experiencing in Europe to Jerusalem and live in a secular society with democracy, etc. It's impossible to predict how that may or may not have worked out, but it is important to recognize that the smartest man in history, who was also a German Jew himself, called the Zionist fascist Nazis. Let's also recognize that Albert Einstein supported socialism and not capitalism. He thought that socialism was the only solution to the predatory phase of human development that they found themselves in during World War II and that we still find ourselves in today. If you want to know more about Albert Einstein's thoughts on socialism and capitalism, you can read about them in his essay, Why Socialism, from 1948. Or maybe I can make a video reading some excerpts from it if you're interested. Leave a comment below and let me know.
The moral litmus test is vastly different than where it was a month ago, 2 months ago, 6 months ago. You have no more excuses to pretend you don't know what's happening. Every fiber of my being feels different. It's not about, do you support Palestine? It's not about, do you feel bad for Palestinians? It's about, what did you do for Palestinians? Or did you sit back and watch? You had a Palestinian in your life, and you've said nothing to them. You've showed no sort of support, no sort of awareness, and you want us to continue doing business with you, speaking with you. Why would I want to get brunch with you? Why would I want to study with you or work alongside you or trust you if you are just an empty skull that has been willingly watching a genocide happen and did nothing about it? Nonetheless, a genocide of my people. And it's very apparent that they're just going on with their lives like nothing has happened. And if you haven't done the self-reflection up to this point, I hope you've realized that your soul is just about as empty as I had suspected. And I will be losing nothing by losing your friendship.
If you are cycling between rage, grief, sadness, anger, then you are very accurately responding to living under a parasitic fascist capitalist system. A system that has exploited our labor, that has normalized us just watching mass death and executions literally happening on screen. A system that says, if you don't wake up in the morning, go to work, pay your bills, you won't be able to feed yourself, you won't be able to house yourself, you won't be able to afford your healthcare. And in the meantime, we're going to create every possible obstacle and barrier for you to organize towards your own liberation, towards Palestinian liberation, towards collective liberation. We're going to render you feeling helpless and hopeless, and we're expected to function under this gaslighting rhetoric that things could be worse. But we live under the same systems that create the conditions for genocide and occupation across the world.
Why do we call the innocent people who have been killed martyrs? And like you point out, there is a connotation and context to the word martyr in English that we don't necessarily intend when we use that word. In Islam, the word for someone who has been unjustly killed or someone who has given their life to God is a shaheed. And shaheed literally means a witness. Now, why do we call them witnesses? Well, one reason is that we don't believe that they actually die when they've been killed. They're still alive in some form, and therefore they are still witnesses, they are still present to all that is taking place. Another reason is that God will bring them on the day of judgment as witnesses, and they will bear witness to the good that they stood up for in their lives and for the evil that ultimately took their lives.
Hamas will surrender, all of this would stop right now. You can't seriously believe that still. Yes, because this is about defending Israel against Hamas and the attack on October 7th. And like I've asked before, what about the West Bank? I feel like we've already established that those people are terrorist sympathizers and Hamas supporters. And Israel has already very clearly established that this isn't about defending Israel or defeating Hamas, this is about expanding Israel. That's a lie. Then why are there Israeli settlers in the West Bank, in Jordan, and in Lebanon? Like, you can't seriously believe that they're going to take the Gaza Strip and just stop there. No one's stopping them. They're going to keep going. This is kind of like exactly what happened in World War II. Well, that land belongs to Israel anyways. But it doesn't. Zionism has just convinced you that it does. Well, what's so wrong with Israel having its own land? Because it's coming at the cost of other people's lives. And again, there were people already there. You have Israeli settlers on camera walking into people's lands with guns, just acting entitled as if it is owed to them. You think that's okay? That's not happening. That's not happening. But it is happening, just like it did to the Jewish people in World War II in Germany. Yet you can't seem to see the similarities.
So in case you needed any other reason to absolutely despise the Israeli occupation forces, I want to tell you the story about a 12-year-old named Aboud. He and many other patients were staying at the Indonesian hospital in northern Gaza. While there, they were forcibly evacuated by the Israeli occupation forces. While the Israeli occupation forces were forcibly evacuating everyone, they were firing live ammunition at patients trying to escape. And then while all of this was happening, the upper floor of the hospital was bombed. Aboud is quoted saying, "All the wounded threw themselves to the ground to avoid the bullets. Bullets were penetrating the walls." Aboud also said that they were not given any choice. Even those who could not sit up because of their injuries were forced to evacuate on a bus. And after the Israeli occupation forces forced them all to evacuate and get on this bus, they stopped the bus shortly after it left the hospital. And Aboud is quoted again saying, "They were mocking us. They kept us all in the cold outside the bus." Y'all, when I say I don't have any words after hearing this.
الغالي يا كولابيرا عزيني في عمري سمعتك وتحياها تفكرت بلادي يا كولابيرا شبهت كل الهدام سمعتك وتحياها تفكرت بلادي يا كولابيرا شبهت كل
This is a very important story, so please keep watching.
Now this is Steve. Steve is a founder at PCRF, and we're going to read some of the emails he received from this boy's father. The first email he received was in September from the father. He was thanking him for the resources for his son, saying, "I am one of the beneficiaries who has benefited." His son had cerebral palsy. He expressed his gratitude in providing systems that he could use. He went on to say that the grant is helping out with medication, and continued showing gratitude. The emails continued being grateful until this day. This is what today's email read. "Hello, Mr. Steve. I'm sorry for this, but I'm writing to you today to tell you that my soul, my kid, Khalil, is gone. He died. He leave us. He was hungry. Actually, his food was not available in markets due to the situation we lived in the Gaza Strip in the war. I was trying to find his food. I found a little, but it was not enough and too late. He leave me. Mr. Steve, thank you for everything you do for my Khalil. Thank you so much for your support, for your feelings. Thank you. Yasser." And for context, Steve is an amazing person and PCRF is an amazing organization. The reality is that humanitarian aid is not being accessed in Gaza, and children are continuing to deal with dehydration and starvation. I'll leave you with this quote.
"Someone tell me why when I was at work today, oh my God, the fucking news was on, right? The news is on and I'm fixing a customer's nail, and all of a sudden I just hear in the background, the death toll in Gaza is over 18,000. This is according to the Gaza Health Ministry, which is run by Hamas." This bitch really brought Hamas up in there like they're fucking lying about the numbers? I know what y'all fucking psychopaths are doing. I know what you're fucking doing. No way you are deflecting from 18,000 deaths because it's run by Hamas. You guys do know that there are two branches to Hamas, right? There's the militant side that we all know of, but then there's also the side that started off as a social service, which is the actual governing branch. So if information is coming out from Hamas about, you know, the death toll, it's gonna be pretty fucking accurate. And yo, I can't just sit there and let the news say shit like that and put ideas into people's heads. Like you people eat this shit up. People eat the shit that's on the news up, okay? I can't just let them sit here and listen to it and think that it's fucking true. So I look over to my customer and I'm like, no way you're trying to deflect from 18,000 deaths just because they're run by Hamas. Because I guarantee you, if I did research on every single point they made, I would find a rebuttal for every single point they made. Me personally, I use the news as an excuse to talk about Palestine. I call that bullshit out whenever I see it, and you should fucking too.
They said they are threatening the house.
"Hello, you do takeaways?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll come over and take away your life.
If you don't close down, we will close you.
F*** you, Israel forever. F*** you.
And we will do to you after we finish in Gaza, we'll do for you more than what we do in Gaza.
I come over and take away your life. Soon."
When the whole thing started, suddenly I came to the restaurant and I see the morale is very low at the staff. And I said, "What's going on?" And they said, "Oh, we are receiving phone calls, and it's a lot, 50, 60, 70 phone calls a day." And I said, "I'll take some of the phone calls and I will listen." And then when I saw it, it made me very angry. At one point, I was thinking to close the restaurant down for a week or two until things calm down, because I thought, we don't need this headache. And some of them used to threaten us and call us like 20 times. the same person, they call you lunchtime, they call you in the evening, especially when you are busy. We got so much support, so much sympathy, that suddenly people say, look, please keep going. If you close, we will get upset. And suddenly, it's the first time in my life I appreciated the meaning of public support. And we have English women came all the way from Brighton just to buy kunafa. I wanted people to know that we have a culture. I wanted people that we are going to be here forever. We are going to carry on. We are going to carry the flag of the Palestinian culture. And we want people to know that we are not going to disappear and we are not going anywhere and we are going to stay there forever. We want to show also the Palestinians who are suffering more, because getting phone calls, this is not suffering. This is harassment. But we want to show them that actually we got more people coming to the restaurant because they feel they are coming to little Palestine, coming to little Gaza. We have a lot of Jewish customers who keep coming, and they call us to apologize every single day. They still come, even they come more, to show us that they are not gonna let these people win. I say, please do not ignore the suffering of the Palestinians, because the world has a test. If you ignore it, nothing will stop other people doing it again and again and again to women and children. It has to stop.
Whenever white people commit crimes against people of color, the media often loves to use the word allegedly. And the word allegedly provides an individual with the period of grace. It means that you are innocent until you are proven guilty and an investigation has to take place. However, that grace is not granted to people of color. And if we just look at the last 2 months, everything that Israel has accused the Palestinian resistance of has been written in the Western media as a fact rather than an allegation. In fact, when Israel reported that 40 Israeli babies were beheaded on October 7th, the Western media wasted no time to report this as a fact rather than an allegation. They never stopped to ask for evidence. And what this did was it grew global outrage, so much to the point that people called for the genocide of Gaza. In fact, people like Lindsey Graham went on national television and said, flatten Gaza. It allowed for this genocide that we are watching now to take place simply because Western media did not provide that grace to the Palestinian resistance. Later, it was found that only 2 babies maximum were killed on October 7th, and they were not beheaded. So who investigates war crimes? Well, it's the International Criminal Court. However, in the past, Israel has refused to cooperate with the ICC. Actually, back in April 2021, Israel said that they would not cooperate with the ICC on war crimes investigations. Why didn't Israel cooperate with the ICC? Because Israel told the ICC it does not recognize the court's authority. What other country has so much power where they can refuse to cooperate with the ICC? That would be the United States of America. The United States of America has never answered for the war crimes that took place in Iraq or in Afghanistan. So what is it that the ICC does? Well, it seems to me that the ICC only ceases to exist to go after Arab and African dictators, and recently Putin, because he's no longer on the good side of Western powers. I think my ask to everyone is that when you're watching or reading, you know, Western media news, be aware of who they're providing grace to and who is not. Because it seems to me that only white people are granted grace. And it's because they want you to believe that people of color are inherently barbaric, uncivilized, and animalistic.
So I met this guy. Oh my god, who? He's kind of a bad boy, but he's addicted to drama. Huh? Like, anytime someone's having an argument, he just inserts himself into it. Wait, show me a pic. No, he's kind of a mess. Also, his apartment's a mess, and he owes a ton of people money. So why doesn't he fix it? Because he spends all his money on drama. Also, his best friend is super toxic. Like, he just breaks into people's apartments and tells them to leave because he's like, I live here now. What? I guess my guy did that too. He kicks people out of their apartments. My guy pays for it. Does he have a job? Not exactly. How does he get the money? For me.
And testimonies that the Israeli forces went into a school in northern Gaza.
There's something interesting I'd like to share with you about that specific school where this incident took place. Based upon its initial investigation, Euromed Monitor confirmed that the individuals were subjected to field unalivings while being questioned by members of the Israeli army at Shadia Abu Ghazala government school. If that name is not familiar to you, I'd like you to be introduced to somebody. This is Shadia Abu Ghazala. She would have been 75 years old on January of this year. Shadia was born in 1948, just 6 months before the Nakba. Abu Ghazala organized and led women's military units and was one of the first Palestinian women to participate in military resistance after the 1967 occupation. She was only 20 years old when she was martyred fighting for liberation. There's been backlash about the naming of the school, and I think that it's no coincidence that the IOF decided to carry out such a heinous act at this school in particular.
75 years ago, 750,000 Palestinians were displaced, 550 villages were destroyed, and over 15,000 Palestinians were killed. And that we call the Nakba. 75 years later, the grandchildren of the Nakba are witnessing the same thing happen again. Over 20,000 Palestinians were killed, over 2 million are displaced, and Gaza is being completely destroyed. You are wrong to think that we won't speak up for our people. You are wrong to think that we won't do everything in our power to continue to advocate for our people and to ensure the freedom and liberation of our land within our lifetime.
Do you know what the kufiya means? Is it just a traditional scarf? It's more than that. It is a symbol of resistance. Fighters used it to hide their identities from the British forces during the 1936 Arab Revolt. The kufiya consists of three main patterns in its design. Fishnet. The larger part of the kufiya is the pattern that represents the fishnet and the relationship between the Palestinian fishermen and the sea. To many Palestinians, the sea also means freedom, especially to those who are living in the West Bank. The olive leaves, which resembles the strength and resilience of the Palestinians that persevered after 75 years under military occupation, bold, represents the trade routes going through Palestine, which played a vital role in carving the history and the rich and diverse culture of Palestinian communities. People around the world wear the kufiya to stand in solidarity with Palestine and its people. So today, wearing the kufiya is more important than ever to show our solidarity.
Here's some background on the settlers in the West Bank that are unaliving my family. My family's from a town in the West Bank known as Burin, and the most radicalized extremist settlement in the West Bank is the Yitzhar settlement. The Yitzhar settlement was built in 1983 on farmland belonging to six Palestinian villages, one of them including my family's, after Israel declared some of this farmland public land. Yitzhar was turned into an official settlement in 1984, and since then they've made tons of illegal outposts. Here's the growth of Yitzhar over the years. The green dots are illegal outposts, and the red dots are settler violence on Palestinians. Just 3 weeks ago, Yitzhar settlers and IDF troops unalived my uncle's neighbor in the West Bank, Mataz. The reason I say Yitzhar settlers and IDF is because they frequently team up to unalive Palestinians. Take a look at the smile on the IDF soldier's face. This was written back in 2021. The settlers uprooted almost 60 fig and olive trees. They then attacked the school with stones and broke its solar panels. The settlers did all of that, and the soldiers covered for them by protection. On top of that, one of the soldiers gave his to a settler. They were shooting together. When the settler was done shooting, he went over to the soldiers and they gave him more ammunition. These are not isolated events, this is a culture. Yitzhar settlement specifically is an extremist group that directly impacts my family. They need to go.
Oppressors think about oppression as an oppositional framework. They have to, in a sense. To the oppressor, opposition is the very thing that is oppression. And they never really address the underlying power structure or oppression itself, because they need oppression to remain intact, to remain in power. And because their thinking is about what is oppositional to them, it always ends up being something like us versus them, winner versus loser, civilized versus savages, hostages versus prisoners. For the oppressor, the fight is to keep oppression from flipping. Oppressors fear with their entire existence that they will become the oppressed. That comes from oppressors believing that power only works by power over. And within oppression, that is how it works. Oppressors believe that the oppressed are trying to flip the dynamic.
But the oppressed who seek liberation aren't trying to flip power, they're trying to distribute power. Power with, power within. Contrasting from the oppressors, the oppressed think about oppression as a potential for community of sorts. It's that my struggle is bound to yours, that we are not free until everyone is free. Our organizing isn't about power over, it's about power with and power within. For the oppressed, the fight is so that oppression itself no longer exists. The aim isn't to keep oppression, but to dismantle it altogether. The oppressor needs the oppressed to exist, but the oppressed do not need the oppressor. Oppressors seek opposition. The oppressed seek community. That's how I know we'll absolutely get to liberation, because power with is always stronger than power over.
Now you're thinking you're sneaky. So the crunchy bitch tells the shitty crunchy chicken bitch to wrap up their ethnic cleansing before the end of the year. It's not a demand, it's just a suggestion. Because I have to defend myself. Because I'm a victim. Isn't the International Court of Justice scheduled to have their public hearings on February 19th? Stop talking about that. What? I don't even acknowledge the legitimacy. All of the member states have written reports about you. I don't find them competent. I don't think they have the competency. Shut up. I'm so excited to hear them all. I want to hear all of the member states talk shit. About your illegal ass occupation, your violation of international law. Do you want me to throw my pine tree in your eye? Violation of humanitarian law. I'm gonna make this scary guy come to the window and stare at you. I'm gonna make him come over here. I'm gonna throw a party. A watching party? It's gonna be like Justin Bieber's roast, but like worse. And we're gonna have popcorn, and you're gonna be able to wear your pajamas. I'm gonna throw my pine tree in your eye! Turkey's gonna be there. And Ireland is gonna be there, and you guys are not invited! You wanna know why? Because you're gonna be too busy trying to defend yourself. Gonna burn. Have this in your eye. And you're gonna be there trying to cover their ass. You're aiding and abetting. Nobody cares what they have to say. I don't care about the 139 member states of the world. Yeah. You're gonna get in trouble. I don't care. Oh shit.
I hope they find you both guilty.
We don't care.
Woo!
Hamas's deplorable exploitation of Gazan civilians as shields. In Saja'ia, Khan Yunis, Rimal, and Jabalia, our troops found large weapons depots and tunnels in multiple schools. There was even a sniper rifle hidden inside a teddy bear.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
I can excuse racism, but I draw the line at animal cruelty.
You can excuse racism.
Happy anniversary to the best thing that ever happened in Bush. And for those of you that didn't know, there's actually a statue of the shoe. Honestly, it deserved more than a shoe.
Don't forget that it's not just about free Palestine, but the Palestine that's freeing us along the way.